Moving forward with the 39 Melachas. You have a few minutes to talk halacha.
Let's do it.
So next melacha in the list of melachos is merakid, sifting. Like you might think, merakid is very similar to borer. Even the Gemara says that. There are different melachos, however, they are very similar. What exactly is merakid? How do we define merakid? When do we definitely say this is an av melacha of merakid?
The Gemara says borer, zore, or merakid are three melachos that are very similar. The idea in all three is to separate good from bad. But as the Rishonim explained, we do them in different ways. We've talked about zore, where we use the wind, a natural force, to separate things. We talked about borer, which could be with the kli, could be with your hand. There are various ways to separate things. And merakid is a later step after we've created flour by grinding up the wheat. Now we have flour and needs to be sifted of its impurities by using a sifter. So what stands out about merakid is that it's specifically when you separate impurities with a sifter, with some kind of device that is made for this purpose. Some relevant questions: what about using a water filter? How about straining noodles or vegetables in a colander? And as can be seen throughout the bakeries of Eretz Yisrael, certainly about now already, what about sprinkling that powdered sugar on top of donuts and other cookies through that little metal net? Is that a problem of merakid when the sugar comes through there? So as always, in order to answer these questions, you have to go back to the basics and understand what the melacha is all about, and then we'll know how to apply the halacha to today's times. Now, as we said, merakid, like the other melachas we mentioned of borer and zoreh, are separating things that are mixed together. And so just like we find by borer, so too with merakid, the fundamental assumption of the melacha is that we're dealing with a mixture and then separating the mixture through a sifter or some other kind of vessel. Therefore, if you have some kind of combination of things that are mixed together, but wouldn't halachically be viewed as mixed together, as we discussed, or a person wouldn't consider them mixed together because they look pretty separate, then it would be permitted. Common example the post can note is, let's say you have some large food, eggs, vegetables in a big bowl of water, and so it's very clear where the water and where the vegetables are. That's not considered halachically mixed, and therefore it would be permitted to pour that through some kind of colander on Shabbos. In contrast, let's say you have noodles and water. There, the water and noodles are all mixed together. It's very hard to tell what's what, and so to run that through a strainer would be an av melacha min haTorah of merakid. Another situation would be the pickles in a pickle jar. If you want to either use the metal cap to keep the pickles back, or you have one of those types of jars that you pick it up in a net and the liquid stays back and you pull out the pickles, so that's using a kli, a vessel of some sort, and it would depend on whether it's considered a taroves, and that would be a question of the ratio between pickles and brine. If there are a lot of pickles and it's really packed in, it's hard to see where the brine is, and it would be a problem. If there are a few pickles and a lot of liquid, it's very clear where the pickles are. It's not a mixture and it would be permitted. Another example, let's say you have a pot of soup and you want to scoop out the vegetables, but you don't want to take too much liquid. And so you'll pick up the vegetables in the ladle and go to the side of the pot and dump out the soup and holding back the vegetables. That would be also potentially a problem with merakid. But again, it would depend on the ratio. If very clearly separated, or certainly at the beginning when you pour out soup and it's very clear that the soup stands alone, then it would be okay. But as it gets towards the end and there's not so much liquid, then it would become a problem because at that point it's mixed and it would be a problem to continue to pour out the soup. Other common examples that we talked about previously are a tea bag, where the tea bag holds in the leaves and lets the liquid drop out. Salt shakers, when you have rice inside, or even if you don't have rice, if you have clumps of hard salt, where again, when you pour out through the salt shaker, this good salt will come out, the bad stuff or the clumps will stay back. That would all be a problem of merakid.
Okay, so as we said, merakid is very similar to borer. In borer, we found that if we do it la'altar, if we do it right away before the suda, it would be considered derech achila, and therefore different variations will be allowed just because it's right before eating, or just because it's during the meal itself.
We saw by Tochen that it was a machlokes where they have such a heter, and we paskin either as a suffek or strongly, like Darach HaShulchan says, that Tochen works. But what about merakid? We don't really find it by merakid in the poskim at all, actually. And the reason would seem to be that anytime you're using a kli, using one of these sifters, that's not something that's part of the eating process. It's not something that's done at table for the meal. To use sifters, that's something that usually happens in an earlier stage in the process, and therefore there is no heter to use it right before the meal. Interestingly, the Rishonim do note that if you would drink directly with a sifter on the bottle cap, that would be okay. Not so common, except let's say you have a baby bottle and there's some kind of particles of formula or whatever in the liquid, it wouldn't be a problem to give the baby that bottle, even if the bottle is holding back those particles from coming through the hole, because that is actually derech achila. So using a sifter right before can't be considered derech achila, but actually eating, that for sure is derech achila. Let's get back to our sufganiyot. What about there? So if the sugar is all pure and clean, and it's just a matter of sprinkling out through that mesh net, then that'll be mutter, because there's no problem with sprinkling something on Shabbos. However, if there are thick clumps of sugar, you'd have to check before, but then it would be a problem of merakid because that net is going to hold the thick clumps back and only the nice, soft, powdery stuff is going to come through. So that would be merakid, and one would have to be careful. Also, the poskim discusses when it comes to matzah meal. Let's say you want to get some nice thin matzah meal and you want to sift it out from the bigger clumps. That would be a problem as well. We should note, though, with all of these things, with the matzah meal, with clumps of salt we mentioned earlier, with the sugar, all of these things have been previously crushed, and it would be okay to break down those clumps because of a principle we mentioned last week of ein tochen achar tochen, that it's not a violation of tochen. Once something has been completely ground and put back together, you cannot violate tochen at a later stage, and therefore in these cases, it would be okay.
Okay, very interesting. But I think one of the most common applications, definitely in Israel, is those water filters we have either on the tap, that little metal thing that actually filters the water when it comes out of the tap, or even larger water filters that filters the water that we drink. Is there any issue of merakid in those kind of things?
Okay, so this is a great question. And in the Shulchan Aruch, it is discussed, and the Shulchan Aruch writes that if the wine or water is clear, it is permitted to filter. Now, the Ramah notes that we have to be talking about a case where there's some kind of dirt in the water, as otherwise there'd be nothing to talk about if it's absolutely pure water. But the Mishnah Berurah explains, what the Shulchan Aruch is saying here is that if the wine or water is in a way that most people would drink it without filtering it, then it's not considered a problem. Now, the Eglei Tal, the Sakhar Chavar Rebbe, raises a question. Why don't we say by a cholent, let's say, well, most people will eat the potatoes, so it's not a problem of borer to separate out the potatoes. We don't find the principle there. The explanation to that is that there, it's objectively two different things. There's potatoes and the barley, beans, whatever else is in the cholent. Here, when we talk about the impurities in the water, the little bit of sediment, dirt, that's all part of the water. So unless a person considers this two separate things, he considers it something that you have to take out, it would not be considered tuminim, and it would not be considered borer at all to put it through a filter. It's just like chopping up one thing into smaller pieces, and that's okay. On the other hand, if something is completely undrinkable, then that would be merakid d'oraisa, because everyone would view these as two separate things that need to be taken apart from each other in order to use the water, and that would be a problem min ha-Torah. And if it's something that most people wouldn't drink, but some people would, somewhere in the middle, then it's a problem midirabanan. So what do we do with our water? What's the story? So the filters on the tap, you mentioned the small filters, those don't really change things in a significant way for the vast majority of people, and therefore there's no problem at all to run water through those filters. The bigger question becomes when you have filters for drinking, the Brita pitchers, or some people have filters on their houses because they want the water to taste better. What about using those filters? So what it comes down to is whether most people would need those filters or not. And I think most situations, people would drink the water without the filters. They may prefer the filters, but that's with the Lashon of the Rishonim. It's achurim tzas. It's a little bit dirty, the water, but not really so dirty that it would affect you from drinking it. And therefore it's mutter and you're allowed to separate it. Now the Mishnah Berurah notes that if a person is an istinus, a person is really a finicky person and would not drink that water at all, then for him, it is a problem in merakid. He would not be able to use it. How do you define this in this? Rav Eliyashiv, the great posek of Yerushalayim who died past decade, he said that if a person wouldn't drink water, if they were absolutely thirsty and tired, then that is a person who would consider finicky, who would really need the filter. And for him, it is a problem. But for everyone else, even if you prefer the filter, but when it comes down to it, if you really need a drink, you would drink the water as is, then it is permitted to use the filter. So you have to know yourself and where that places you. I'd venture to guess that for most of us, if we'd really be stuck, we drink the water and wherever we are, and therefore it is permitted to use all of the filters on Shabbos to clean out the water. Now in New York City, some hold that you have a bigger problem, and that is that there are bugs that are halakhically problematic in the water. Of course, there are always microscopic bacteria and things in everything that we eat. That's not a problem. Halakha doesn't recognize things that are microscopic, but things that can be seen by the naked eye are a problem. It's a bit of a debate in the contemporary poskim in New York whether the cocoa pods that are found in the water are considered halakhically visible to the naked eye. Those who are machmir would require a filter to drink. If that's the case, then you would not drink without the filter. You need the filter to drink, even if you're stuck, because it's halachically a problem. The Minchas Chinuch does have a question that maybe borer doesn't apply to halachic problem. If it's only what we perceive as a problem, that's considered borer. But if it's a halachic, a spiritual problem, it's not considered borer. But we'd rather not rely on that, and therefore most posts can say that one cannot use those filters on Shabbos and won't have to air the water in advance. I did hear from Rav Schechter Shlita, the posik of the OU, who in deference to the fact that some disagree and hold that these bugs are not a problem, and we have the Minchas Chinuch that says that spiritual psoles that you only care about because of the halacha is not considered psoles, and perhaps one other combination, he thinks it is permitted to filter the water, so there are different opinions for those who are machmir about it, whether you're allowed to use the filters in New York City. But again, if you'd be okay drinking without the filter, then it would be permitted to filter the water, because again, that's not halachically a problem, and therefore it's okay.
Great, shkoyach.
And as always, have a great time with you, Tevye.
Same here, and in Mitzvah Shem, we'll continue the Melachos next week.
For more short and fast-paced Talking Torah clips, make sure to check out our YouTube channel.